everyone, good evening. This is Dr. Praveen Ramachandra. I will be the moderator for this session. The topic for today's webinar is do's and don'ts for doctors in the COVID-19 pandemic. This webinar is brought to you by Umda Healthcare, the initiative of Umda Healthcare. So in the era, in the time of pandemic of corona, everything is new to us. For everybody, not for health sector, even for government or any other sectors in the country, it is a very new thing and it has almost stopped the way we were doing the things. And very importantly for doctors also and other healthcare professionals as well. So many things we don't know, because since it is a new situation, we don't know what we should do, what we should not be doing. Because somebody in the WhatsApp has sent that, just you miss something, you may get into the risk of getting virus infection, like something like that. So you should be always cautious, because something is new and is highly infectious disease. So what are the do's and don'ts? So with this, I would like to introduce our speakers for today. Dr. Chalapathy, he is MBBS, MD and DM Gastroenterology from PGI Chandigarh. And he is presently working as consultant gastroenterologist in KIMS, Vizag, Andhra Pradesh. And second speaker will be Dr. Abdul Khaliq. He is also gastroenterologist, trained in PGIMR, Chandigarh. And he is the CEO of Umad Healthcare. And he works in Hyderabad, Telangana. These are the topics for today. When outside the hospital, what the healthcare professionals should be cautious about. And when inside the hospital, what are the do's and don'ts? And whatever the critical staff training is involved, because you train yourself, if you don't train your staff very well, still you can get contact the coronavirus infection and it can spread across either side. And what are the structural changes which requires, because it's a new thing, what are the structural changes either in your clinic or hospital is required? That will be the fourth topic. Each topic will be 10 minutes. After that, we'll have an answer session. With this, I invite Dr. Abdul Khaliq to speak about what the healthcare professional should do and don't do when he's outside the hospital or in the OP. Please, Dr. Abdul Khaliq.
Yeah, good evening everybody. Thanks for joining us for this webinar. We have also shared the YouTube link in the groups. For the people who fail to go into the YouTube, they can please log in into the YouTube link and give the comments. And thanks Dr. Praveen for organizing this one. And yeah, we will start with the first topic. The first topic of mine is what a doctor should do right from his journey from home, starting from home till coming back to home, and what else to do. So that will be the first topic of which I will be touching. The second topic, Chalapathy will be dealing what to do in the hospital, and then we'll proceed accordingly. So first of all, if we are working as a team, it's always better to divide the work between the teams, not as an alternate day or once in 3 days. It's always better to divide a 15-15 days, because particularly if, for unfortunately, if some of us will come in direct contact with a with an unknown COVID positive patient, or if some of us become positive to this one, if both the consultants are in touch with the patient, then both of them has to go for home quarantine and the work of the department will completely come to a shut. So it's always better when two or more people are there as a working as a team, or in a bigger departments where there are so many consultants, it's better to divide the work of 15 days each, so that for the first 15 days, one team will be working, and for the second 15 days, the other team will be working. The changes that are required are, because we need to take regular showers, though it is summer, but still we need to take at least twice a day a regular shower from head bath. So it's always better to cut our hair to the bare minimum, though there is a scare of going towards the barbers which is there, but still we need to cut the hair to the bare minimum. The second thing that we need to change in our appearance particularly for people like me who have bird, or for the people who have a larger bird, is to shave the bird to the neatest possible way, because that will help in the snugly fitting of the mask whenever we go for our clinical work. So from home, after taking the shower and leaving to the hospital, one approach is I wear the scrubs right from the home and then I go to the hospital, which I think is the preferred approach. The second approach is, once we go to the hospital, the first thing that we need to do is go to the changing room and change from our formal coats into the scrubs. We need to avoid all unnecessary accessories which we generally take, like the watches, the wallets, the jewelry, particularly the female consultants or female doctors. And the bare minimum things has to be taken while going to the hospital. And we need to find some old pair of footwear, so that during the once this time period of the COVID infection is done, these footwear can be thrown away. And particularly in my home or in the apartment or also in the hospital, it's always better to avoid the lifts and escalators for two reasons. One thing is, these are the locked up places wherein the aerosols can be there and crowding of the places will be there. Second thing is, as we are in the lockdown, there is a lack of physical activity, and getting up the stairs of a few floors will provide some amount of at least some physical activity. It's better to drive self, because we don't know, because of, with each and every person we are coming into interaction, whether it be our driver, our cook, or our housemaid, or our staff, each and every one are potential to have this infection. So it's better to have minimal contact, and it's better to drive by ourselves. It's a good idea to keep a large sticker on the car that we are a doctor on duty. Otherwise, particularly in the cities like Hyderabad, there is regular checking and by the police and interrupting to see why we are going and where we are going. So it's a good idea to keep a large sticker on the car that we are doctor and we are on duty. Within the car, it's better to keep the Bluetooth if it is available in the car. If a Bluetooth facility is not there, so many speakers are available wherein our phone can be attached to the Bluetooth, so that repeated touching of the phone can be avoided right from the car itself. Some extra things I generally put up in the car for the doctors who have the car, but for a few doctors or for DMOs or for the students who are going on their two-wheelers, all these things may not be required. They can simply replace this one with a small bag which will have a polythene within it, which can be easily disposed. But for the consultants who have the car, these are the extra fittings that I keep within the car. One is a small dustbin wherein I can keep all the things that I remove. I keep a sanitizer with me, either a spray sanitizer, alcohol based, which with a gas or a simple push type of a sanitizer in the car. The third thing is I tend to keep my regularly wearing mask, preferably a N95 mask with me in the car. I keep a few covers of my footwear, shoe covers within my car, as well as a box with tissue papers in the car. As well as to keep the face mask, I generally use a glass made up of either Tupperware or such type of a glass made tiffin box. Or second thing is, if I don't have the facility of this type of a box, then I can use a simple brown paper wherein I can keep my mask after coming from the work. So in the car, these are a few fittings which I suggest. One thing is the four upper things I think are mandatory. One is a dustbin, second one is a hand sanitizer extra in the car, and shoe covers, as well as the box to keep the masks. Other things which are optional but recommended are keeping tissues, a few more masks, because if the police or someone interrupt while driving, it's better we keep this mask and low down our window and then speak to them, and we can keep for extra gloves whenever they are required. So once I step out of the car, I am wearing my scrubs from the home, and once I reach my hospital, what I am doing is I am putting in the face mask by myself. I am wearing the shoe covers, putting some tissue, paper tissues within my pocket to use it, and using a pocket sanitizer. I'm not using any accessories. This is how I would ideally be looking while I step out of the car. And it's always better to avoid giving our car keys to the valet parking, because most of the corporate hospitals where we work, there are facilities of the valet parking. It's better if we take it to the place of parking and we park by ourselves. And we have to remember that whenever we get a free time, it's always better not to indulge in a lot of chit-chat, because our colleagues and the staffs who are present in the hospital are more potential sources of corona infection rather than our patients. So once I finish my clinical work, from this point to what to do in the hospital will be dealt in a few minutes with by Chalapathy. Once I finish my clinical work, I come back to the car, and with the tissues that are present in my pocket, I open the door handle door by using the tissues, and inside the dustbin that I have shown, I'll be putting in the. Once I am within the car, I will put on the tissues within the dustbin, and the shoe covers that were present in that dustbin, as well as the mask that I am going to wear, I will be taking in my Tupperware or a glass box or within the paper cardboard. And all those things, so after I go home, I am not going to throw it outside, because these are biological and hazardous waste. I keep it aside, and then the next day when I go to the hospital, I'm going to carry this polythene bag with all the waste, and I'm going to give it to the hospital management system so that they dispose it off in a proper way. And once I'm at home, after parking the car, going to my room, first thing that I do is I remove my shoes outside of the home, keep it in the rack before entering the home. It's better not to take the shoes within the home. And opening of the door, I tend to keep one tissue box by the side of my door. So I take one tissue, open the knob. Though we clean the knobs of the doors regularly with the sanitizer, but it's a simple idea to keep a tissue box by the side. So whenever we are opening, we can take one tissue and open the door. And once we are inside, by the side of the door, it's better to keep one more trash box wherein these tissues can be thrown. After entering the home, the first place that I go in is my bathroom, wherein I remove all my clothes, put it in the washing machine, add some detergent, preferably with some hot water, and wash the clothes in the washing machine with the semi-automatic or a dryer thing. And then I take the shower. I take the shower with the head, with a proper scrubbing of the hands, hair, and everything. And once only then I come out and I speak to my family members or etc. It's better to maintain a separate room. This is particularly important for the people who are posted in the hospitals wherein the COVID infection is there, and particularly in the people who are high risk of getting exposed to these COVID-19 patients, like the people in the ICU, etc. But otherwise also all patients who are coming to our hospitals or clinics are to be considered as the potential patients. So keeping a separate room and a separate bathroom is always preferable. So there is a concept of toilet room now, as evidence is coming that rectal swabs as well as within the stools also the COVID infection is seen up to around a minimum of 11 days post discharge. So while flushing the toilet, if the lid is not properly closed, small aerosols can be generated, which can go up to as much as 6 to 10 inches or sometimes even more, and these are the potential of infection. So within the home, it's better within the hospital, it's better to avoid the toilet as much as possible, but within the home also, if we are using it, proper sanitization should be there, flushing should be done after closing the lid, and there should be a gap to other person using the same toilet if they are using. And even within the home, particularly with the elderly people or with our other family members, if they are having comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, etc., we should maintain a minimum distance of 1 to 2 meters. Social distancing or physical distancing is a must. We have to be mentally prepared and speak with and communicate with our family, particularly with our elders as well as the kids. These family times are awaited till this pandemic is over, which may take a few months, so that they doesn't feel that we are distancing themselves. And most important thing is, even with the slightest of our infections, whether it be myalgia, fever, or sore throat, the threshold for getting investigated, getting ourselves investigated, should be high. So we should not ignore our symptoms, because we will be keeping not only the patients and staff but also our family into at the peril. So apart from this one, these are a few S's which we advocate: taking daily a good amount of sunlight and some supplements of vitamins, particularly with antioxidants, having good sleep, stretches and exercises, having a connection with the Almighty, that is spirituality and meditation, taking a smoothie wherein we take good amount of fiber and micronutrients so that our microbiome is healthy, and eating in a very sensible manner, and to stop smoking if at all we have any habit, and always maintaining the social distance is important. Yeah, thank you. Praveen.
Thank you, Dr. Kalik. Now we'll move on to the next topic. When you enter into the hospital, what we should not do and what we should do. Over to you, Dr. Chalapathy.
Questions we can take at the end?
At the end, yeah.
Good evening. I am Dr. Chalapathy, gastroenterologist at Visakhapatnam. First of all, thank you all for joining here. In this difficult times, I hope all of you are safe. Am I audible and visible? My slides are visible?
Yes, your slides are visible. Yeah, is it visible?
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, right. So, Dr. Khalik has given an overview of what we are going to do outside of our hospital to protect ourselves and our family also. We are almost coming to the end of our lockdown and some relaxation period, we have to increase our visits to hospital and start our OPDs or procedures or do inpatient visits in due course. So I'm going to discuss about certain points, what we should do and we should not do while we are doing our rounds or daily patient care in hospital. So this may not be a great science, but it comes out of our common practice of infection control during these difficult times. So we should know what we should do and we should not do, but also we should also let others, and including our staff, involving in paramedical staff or admin staff like that, what they should do and they should not do. And in my second part of the topic, I'll be taking care of changes to be made in the clinic or in the hospital to suit the current COVID pandemic. So this is the hierarchy of controls that is established by the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Hazards. So this is the hierarchy that is starts from PPE to protect the personal protective equipment. There can be administrative control changes where there will be a change in the way that people will work. There can be changes in the engineering controls, that is to isolate the people from the hazard, that is COVID. There can be substitution. You can replace the hazard if somebody is infected. Some normal person can be replaced. And if there is any change in the protocol, we can replace so that we can combat the hazard. And ultimately, we can eliminate the hazard, physically remove the hazard, like take off the person from the hospital, shift to the other hospital where a better care is needed, like that. So this is the hierarchy of controls, and we follow from least effective to most effective. We should not forget all these things when we enter into the hospital: an N95 mask, scrubs, and we should completely protect ourselves. No skin area should be exposed when we are taking care of the patients, and we should be constantly following the hand sanitizer disinfection policy. And why I actually put up a second pair of gloves is when we are actually examining the patient, it is always advisable to change a second pair of gloves of a different color so that we'll be remembering this protocol. So that each and every patient, after each and every patient examination, we can remove the outer gloves. If it is colored in a different coat like a blue or brown, we'll remember that. So before start of the day, it is always ideal when you step out of the car at the security entrance itself, get your fever checked, and that gives us an example to others so that if a doctor is getting checked at the security, then the rest of the patients and other staff members also get checked at the security entrance. And if there are any signs of fever like that, then obviously it needs to be addressed before start of the work. This will also remove a stigma that is prevailing among your staff for testing. And leave all your belongings in the car, as already told, and remember to hand sanitize regularly with alcohol-based hand rubs. So before start of the day, if you have not already changed at home, so change to scrub suits provided in the hospital, or if you have a personal equipment, and immediately, and use these clothes throughout the day in the hospital, and change to hospital shoes as well. It is preferable to wear an overall or apron over the scrub suits for additional protection. It is always preferable to have an inner pair of gloves. And remember to hand sanitize even the inner pair of gloves regularly, and keep minimum staffing to avoid more number getting exposed to the patients. And it is always important to identify the staff who are older than 60, who are immunocompromised, who have some comorbid conditions like diabetes or hypertension, and you can shift them to non-COVID areas or assign them some job of telehealth to limit the exposure to the direct patient care. So you can check your staff before start of the OPD. You can check your staff, talk to them, and if they have any suspicious symptoms for themselves in their home or in the neighborhood, just inquire. And if there is any suspicious feature like that, then deal with it and be polite with them rather than shouting at them, why have you come to the hospital like that? So, because they also need the care. And encourage them to practice the same way what you're doing. Doctors may not be the perfect, but we have to go to near perfection, and it is the simplest way to tell them, practice whatever I am doing. And educate them regularly about the care to protect themselves from getting the risk of getting infected from the OPD patients. And educate them how to identify the patient suffering from COVID-19 disease, like symptoms like fever, sore throat, myalgias, cough, etc. And it is always a good idea to ask them to fill up patient symptom questionnaires, forms, checklist forms, and disclosure statements at the front desk itself when they are waiting at the waiting area. And any patient having any of these positive symptoms or suspicious of COVID-19, they can be identified and they should be sent to the emergency at the nearest COVID-19 hospital. And always deal with your staff in a polite way. The staff may be very much anxious and depressed in these difficult times. So please take the responsibility to boost up their morale and educate them with proper techniques of usage of PPE and handle the situation very smoothly, like donning and doffing, etc. You need to continuously educate them. So these are certain precautions we keep following regularly. And most importantly, don't shake your hands with anybody. That is most important. Whenever you see your colleague or your staff member or any close patient or any known to patient, so please avoid hand to handshake. So it is always a good idea to maintain a separate OPD for suspected patients just at entering before the hospital itself. So if anybody is having a suspicious symptom, then they will be screened there itself. And run some COVID-19 related education videos in the television available in the OPD waiting areas near your chamber, so that people will actually get what are the facts. And in fact, if possible, you directly talk or make a video and post it on the television so that they can have a confidence. So these are some of the disclosure and questionnaire forms that we follow at our hospital in Vizag, where patient will be following this and they will be signing it up. And the questionnaire includes travel history, any contact, if there is any fever, sore throat, dry cough, etc. And sometimes with the risk of nosocomial COVID infection, sometimes a normal patient can also get infected unknowingly, and they may create medical legal problems to the hospital and the clinic. So it is always better to encourage them to have been wearing a face mask and carry a hand sanitizer, but still they can have they can contract a nosocomial infection. So it is always better to let them sign this informed consent so that you will be protected. So before start of the day, ensure that all your belongings, including a pen, wallet, phone, watch, kitchen keys, keys, chains, rings, ornaments, and belts are not carried with you. Either they can be kept in the car or safe locker, preferably in the car itself. All the patients and relatives present should be wearing a mask, and educate them to use hand sanitizer regularly. So these are the certain things. The first two things, you can use a Bluetooth. You can carry two sets of Bluetooth, one at home and another in the hospital, and you need not exchange it so that the risk of carrying infection is less. You can use a Ziploc cover to cover your cell phone, and you can handle the cell phone through the cover itself. But preferably, it is better if you handle it through a Bluetooth or hands-free mode, or you can give it to a non-medical assistant so that they can handle any calls for you. And remember, all these patient care equipment like stethoscope, thermometer, pulse oximeter, or patient weight scale, and sphygmomanometer, all these things should be disinfected regularly after each patient use. It is very, very important. And when you're in the chamber, while examining, use a second pair of gloves of a different color to touch the patient, and wipe out the stethoscope and other patient examination between each patient. Change the outer gloves between each patient. It is very important. And wipe off the pen, table, chairs, examination couch, computer, keyboard, computer monitor, doorknobs, etc. with alcohol wipes after entry and exit of patients and relatives. So it is very important. You can take alcohol. There are some disinfectant wipes available, or you can use the regular alcohol scrub to spray and then wipe it off with the tissue. And similarly, most importantly, the elevator knobs also need to be disinfected. All the formats need to be disinfected because they still carry the risk of transmitting the infection. As much as possible, avoid touching the face when you are showing your emotions with the patient. If you are showing some empathy towards patients, sometimes we use these kind of gestures by touching the face, nose and eyes. And don't do that even with the gloved hands. Avoid close contact with the patient while examining or talking to the patient relatives. OPD can be conducted in halls rather than rooms. Certain of my colleagues, they do practice that, but this might cause a breach of identity and may not be accepted by many patients, especially female patients and elderly patients. And but the advantage is, if we do such kind of OPDs in halls, that might avoid handling of doors and handles. But an alternative is, you can use curtains to protect the patient privacy even in open halls, and you can still continue running the OPDs. And remember to disinfect these curtains as well. The other precautions is, use fresh paper for each prescription each time. Don't turn around the paper and use the same paper, because it might be carrying some infection. And after the OPD, advise the patients and relatives to use alcohol sanitizer and not to touch anything with their hands, especially the staircase handles, lift doors, and lift control buttons. If at all they need to do, they need to handle it with gloves or using some tissue paper like that. And ensure the same precautions and steps are followed at the pharmacy and lab also. It is very important. And at the front office, lab, pharmacy, a transparent acrylic screen can be placed to use a barrier as a barrier between the hospital staff and patient relatives. So I'll be dealing all some of these things in my next part of the lecture. And most importantly, never forget washrooms that are present in the patient waiting halls. Ensure only one person utilizes the washroom at any time. Ensure proper flush of the excreta and cleaning of the excreta and urine on the floor, pan, lead, and other places. And please educate them to close the lid first and then flush it so that there will not be any aerosol spread. Encourage use of soap and water to clean the hands after use, and ensure the proper disinfection of these rooms with sodium hypochlorite after each usage, including the doorknobs, pistons, and taps. Encourage to air dry or use toilet tissue to clean the hands and properly dispose it off in the appropriate bin. And finally, whenever possible, encourage telemedicine consultation for non-urgent patients, especially follow-up patients who want to refill their prescriptions. This would reduce the crowding and physical contact, but understand the telemedicine guidelines first before following that. And if there is any doubt, please do not hesitate to call the patient for physical examination with full protection, because patient safety is of prime importance. Few words about inpatient care. So, many physicians, they deal with COVID patients, including the ICU staff, the emergency doctors, but a few of the gastroenterologists also, they do get calls because certain patients, they have GI symptoms. It is always important to identify and maintain the COVID and non-COVID zones first in the hospital, including ICU, maintain the same precautions for infection control, but follow it more stringently as there will be more sicker patients, shift to full gear personal protective equipment for all IP care, and minimize the number of, most importantly, minimize the number of physical visits. Like if you have a habit of seeing your patients twice or thrice per day, minimize it, and also minimize the staff while you're on rounds, especially physician assistants, interviewers, patient counselors, etc. And also avoid duplicate staffs if you can assign multitasking to the minimum size of staff. Utilize the patient examination, patient care equipment in dedicated way for each patient without exchange, very important. There is a habit of using the same BP machine to multiple patients, stethoscope to multiple patients, which can transmit the infection. And encourage the staff to keep, if there is a ventilator or a defibrillator, rather than assigning to each and every patient, it is always better to take off these life-saving equipment to a common area and keep a lock of it. And if there is any need, then transfer this equipment to the patient care area. Otherwise, if they are lying free in the patient care area, they can carry some infection. So it is always better to isolate them from the patient care area, but keep it in the nearby area. And avoid visitors, patient roaming outside for an evening walk like that, and avoid mixing up with non-COVID patients. And it's very important to educate the security staff, nursing staff, housing staff, housekeeping staff, and administrative staff about the infection control practices. What about cross consultations? For example, if the COVID patient or some other patient is admitted with some other primary care physician, you'll be called for that there is a diarrhea, there is jaundice, there is hepatitis. So gastroenterologist will be called. And before doing that, please remember that up to 11 to 15% of patients can have GI symptoms, including diarrhea, nausea, and vomiting. Up to 75% of patients can have liver enzyme abnormalities, as reported in various series. And up to 10% of patients can have jaundice. Especially these abnormalities and GI symptoms can be more severe, especially liver injury in more sick and severe patients. So be careful, especially in ICUs. Try to avoid multiple doctor consultations. This is very important because the primary care consultant will call you, come and see the patient. It's better to avoid multiple doctors having a physical consultation for a single patient. You can just consult the patient from outside. So what my advice is, one primary doctor can see the patient and others can review his records outside the patient area and be available for phone consultation. That is important, and that is enough also in these difficult times. So if there is any emergency procedure is needed, always follow the standard precautions, and part of it will be discussed in my next talk. So most importantly, protect yourself, but your staff also should be taken along with you as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chalapathy. It's very insightful. And going by the Dr. Karlik's first talk and Dr. Chalapathy's talk, I'm sure that including me, many of the attendees or many of the doctors will be following only 3 to 5% of what the speakers could tell that. How much we should be cautious. So it's good that we have this webinar much before the community spread is occurring or before the lockdown is over. So I move to this next important topic, that is by Dr. Abdul Khaliq, that about staff training in the medical sector. Please, Khaliq.
Thanks, Chalapathy. Thanks for the very good insight that you have given us. I'll be speaking a few insights of mine about staff training, though I won't be going into the nitty-gritty of each and every step of how to train staff and what are the different protocols. But overall, I will try to give some of my insights of involving the staff into the management of our patients in the clinics or in the hospitals where we are practicing. So the first of all, the importance of training the staff is particularly, we should take care of their safety. And if they are not well trained, they are likely to do mistakes. And by doing mistakes, they will become potentially infected with the infection, as well as they are also having the potency of spreading the infections to the patients who come to the hospital, as well as to ourselves. And once, as we have seen a few reports, if some number of healthcare professionals are turned out to be positive within a hospital, the hospitals are being closed, and which will be a big financial loss, as well as a bad reputation to the hospital, as well as the doctors who are practicing over there. So adequate training of the staff is a quintessential important step for each and every one of us before we start our practice. So there should be a change in our mindset as the lockdown is finished, and after Monday, as the government of India has allowed the clinics to be opened, we should not be in a mode of get set, go, go, let us go and let us start our practice without properly training our staff. So there should be at least three aspects where our staff should be trained. First thing is about the self-defense of self-protection from the coronavirus infection. Second thing is, as a team, how should we gel up to maintain each and every steps of our hospital functionings, as well as how we should be helping our patients during these times, wherever the patients are either positive or potentially positive patients. These are the three areas which we should be training our staff. So before training our staff, we should have a very clear-cut design of what actually we need to train our staff. Before that one, we need to see what are actually their insights about the disease of a coronavirus infection, and what they should be knowing, and why they should be knowing, and how to train. And at last, after training them, we should evaluate them, that are they having adequate knowledge to protect themselves and to carry on the day-to-day activities of the hospital. Once we think that they are having fairly good potency of carrying out the day-to-day hospital activities, only then they should be given a green signal to serve the hospital. So first of all, we have to understand what actually are their insights. For that, either a simple Google form or a paper thing or a simple form can be given to understand about them, what actually is their understanding about the disease. And we have to take their insights, how they want to protect themselves, what changes should be done in their each and every specific areas. Like front office area is different from a pharmacy area is different from an OT area is different. So we should be involving the members of different places in the hospital and try to get their insights from them. And we should try to encourage them to come up with the ideas how to implement them. And we should always listen to their concerns. So most of the ideas of how to implement and tweak, whether structurally or functionally, will be provided mainly by our staff who is working with us. So the first thing is, rather than we giving them the protocols, okay, do this one, this one, this one, it's better to involve them from each and every aspect, particularly the staff people who are quite active, and try to listen to them and implement them. So get the ideas from them and try to incorporate them. And reward them regularly. So by rewarding them, there will be a sense of encouragement, and more staff people will be coming with much, much better ideas to implement within the hospital during these periods. Second important aspect of staff training is what they exactly need to know. The one aspect what they exactly need to know is what is called as PPE, but PPE is only one aspect. There are many other aspects and protocols that are required. The best way of training them is virtually, rather than making them to sit in the class and going to the board and training. It's always better if we make all short videos of how to don, how to doff, what are the PPE equipment which are required, how to use them, how to dispose it, if at all, if we need to reuse some of them, like N95 masks, how we need to reuse it, they are reusing it in a personal way. So how to deal with the money when the patients give, how to take blood samples, or how to shift the patient from one place to another. There are so many protocols which can be designed in the short videos, which we have to circulate to the staff according to their specialty. Once they get trained, we need to evaluate them, and then we have to proceed. So first thing is, they should be knowing about protecting themselves. They should have a clear-cut understanding of personal protective equipment, how to doff or how to wear that equipment, how to take out that equipment, dispose and reuse those equipment should be there. They should have a clear-cut understanding that just not the mask alone is important, but how we fit the mask and how we check that it is properly fit on this one, and what are the different other gear to be used according to their specialty, particularly if they are some of the staff members within the sanitation, what is the importance of using a long boots, etc., etc., has to be re-emphasized. Second thing is, once we re-emphasize that one of the insights is, we can make a team of 2 people or 3 people as a small team, give them the videos, and once they are trained, once the patient, for example, donning and doffing of the PPE is there, once the other person is donning and doffing, at that time, the other team member will be looking and correcting him and taking a video, and these videos can be sent to the person who is monitoring them. And once we are sure that this person is doing according to a protocol all the things, then we can allow them to serve our patients. So as a single size will not fit to everyone, making just a few protocols and giving to the patients in different areas will not work. We need to customize the protocols to each and every different aspect of the hospital. The protocols in the front office will be slightly different when compared to the lab, when compared to the nursing in the OPD, to OT, to nurses who are working in the ICU. So we should involve them and customize the protocols which will fit them the most. Second aspect which we need to train our staff is about the teamwork. Mock drills should be done, particularly in the hospitals, about different aspects of a hospital, like moving in the patients, or during surgery, or endoscopy, or shifting of the patients, or bedding, cleaning of the patients, etc., etc. These need to be done by wearing the proper PPE. So doing, as shown in this picture, wearing a simple mask is there and not a proper PPE is there, but by wearing the whole gear, how difficulty will be there for the staff to actually do these procedures has to be trained before. The third aspect is different aspects of what we call it as the moments of truth within the hospital has to be written it down or has to be marked. Like after coming to the hospital till they leave the hospital, for each and every staff member, what are the type of the clothes that they have to, or the outfit they have to wear and come, and what should be their workplace etiquettes should be there, and how their eating habits should be, and while using the bathrooms, how to use them, and what to do after going to home. All these things has to be discussed. As short videos has to be given to them, and should emphasize them to follow these things. The sanitation, as Chalpati has discussed, and previously we discussed the concept of toilet fume. So using of the toilets has to be minimum within the hospital, and a proper sanitation of the of all the aspects of the hospital, not only the toilets, but the seats where the patients are sitting, the bathrooms, the beds, door knobs, etc., has to be taken properly. And the third aspect that we need to discuss with our staff are what are the probable scenarios that can arise during this period. Patient can come without an attendant, a problematic patient may be coming, or a patient may be requiring more support by travel or something, or what happens when a patient is collapsing within the hospital, or such type of different scenarios. We need to make a thought process of this one, and how we need to react to each and every scenario has to be made clear cut and to be discussed with the patients. And obviously during these times we will be requiring more coordinators. Praveen, getting voice of someone else.
Please go ahead.
There should be more coordinators, and we have to differentiate at different things by mainly by time rather than the space, particularly in the OPDs. Rather than spreading the patients at different places, I think it's better to spread them by time rather than primarily and secondarily by place. And more innovations are in waiting. Once we involve our staff, they will be coming with so many new ideas what to do at different aspects. A few of the things that I'm sharing with you people. One thing which is common in most of the hospitals is taking the attendance by using the fingerprint sensors, which are again the potency of spreading. So after using this one, or prior to using this one, always using an alcohol-based sanitizer should be implemented. Opening of the doors. What should be the protocols, whether they have to be some sensors which open by themselves, or should we keep them completely open, or are there any means by which we can open it by using other parts of the body, has to be seen depending upon each and every hospital, and a thought has to be given to them, that one. During phlebotomy, like we used to go to movies to take the tickets, can such a thing can be implemented wherein the patient can give his hand and the phlebotomist on the other side of the screen of the glass can take the blood sample from the cubital fossa, has to be explored. The pharmacy, instead of explaining to the patient physically what medicines has to be taken at what time, morning, evening, etc., etc., such type of boxes or such type of simple brown covers, like one in the morning, one in the afternoon, one in the night, the different medicines can be kept into that one and can be handed to them. And they have to be constantly counseled by keeping so many counselors, or a very good virtual counseling team or a counselor should be there who should be explaining to the all the patients, because we need to see the hierarchy, the physical communication between the staff, workers, and the patients is going to come down during this period, so which has to be compensated by virtual counseling. If not by the doctor, then there should be an adequately trained staff who should be trying to fill up this gap. And particularly, sharing of the pens is quite common in the staff, which should be avoided. So everyone should have their own particular pens. And as we discussed previously, different accessories, both for the male doctors as well as the female doctors, should be as much limited as possible while in the hospital. Coming to the phones, there can be multiple policies, but I suggest that most of the, like in the IT companies, most of the phones should not be allowed to the hospital. Once they come to the hospital, they have to be deposited somewhere or kept within the locker, and a common number should be shared with the family members, so that if some emergency is there, they can see it. Because of the presence of phone and the social media, most of us have the habit of going to our social media or WhatsApp and looking it whenever we are free. So it's better if the smartphones are kept while coming to the hospital, and while going out, if they are taken, that is good. And whatever the emergency comes, someone will be there to communicate to us if it comes from our family. The second thing is, in the hospitals, in particularly in the wards, it's always better to use the phones rather than using the receiver at the ear as well as the mouthpiece. It's always better to install the phones with the speaker, which can be easily sanitized. So each and every time, whenever a call comes, they can see from which ward the call is coming. And by sanitizing this one and opening the speaker, they will be able to listen as well as communicate, by which the chances of infection will be much lower. The same is again the canteen. Rather than giving the time period of 1 to 2 for the lunch, we can break it by time. Okay, by one group can go somewhere from 11 o'clock till 3:30. We can group this one, and we need to rearrange our canteens so that while sitting, the distance, social distance or the physical distance is maintained, and the time can also be split of one staff going to the other staff. Yeah, mainly the money transaction has to be mostly in the digital platforms. If you are using some type of card swipe, these things has to be regularly sanitized. There should be a protocol of how money has to be taken, because while counting money, it's a common habit for most of us to use the saliva to count the money, which is again a potentially risky thing. So a clear-cut protocol of how to take the money and where to keep the money and when to reuse it has to be in place within the hospitals. Yeah, as we know that coronavirus doesn't differentiate between a poor person or a rich person. It can infect both the poor person and the rich person, and younger people and adult people. In the same way, in the hospital, we should also should not try to differentiate between the doctors or the high-end consultants versus the other staffs like a janitor or a security person. Whatever the appropriate PPE is there, we should ensure that all our staff should be getting an adequate PPE. And during these times, some of the staff may have significant fear. We need to communicate with them, give some support psychologically, and some of them will be requiring even the financial support. We should be there to help them out in our hospital or clinic setups. And some of our staff members may be so frightened that they may prefer not to work. In such a scenario, we should give the choice to them to take a break for some time, but we have to support them both psychologically as well as financially whenever it arises. So guiding them, assisting, advising, supporting, and help is the other leadership role that all the doctors should take apart from our routine clinical practice. So the difference between a boss and a leader, as we know, that boss is generally throws the orders to do this one and that one. Rather than that one, we should be at the forefront and showing them the way that how we need to manage the patients. And this is a adequate time wherein we try to show our leadership skills. As was said by one of the very famous entrepreneur, Mr. Richard Branson, sir, I truly believe that if you take care of your employees, they will take care of your business. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kalik. So it's a wonderful sessions we had and very insightful. So now I invite Dr. Chalapathy for structural changes in clinic and hospital. So what's happening is it's like a warlike situation. So Donald Trump tells it is a war, PM Modi tells it's a war. So we need to change a lot of things. So till now what we is doing and post-COVID is going to be a very different thing. And Dr. Chalapathy to talk about what are the structural changes required in a simple clinic or a big hospital to fight this. Please, Dr. Chalapathy.
It may not be an individual decision, but it is a collective decision between yourself with the management and the admin. And it may involve a lot of cost, but sometimes it may have to be done to control the infections and protect everybody. There are no specific guidelines, but it again generally goes with the general practice of infection control, social distancing, and minimizing the infection. So before going that, I want to bring you few facts about the Indian scenario. So you know the most contagious problems, the most communicable problems are pneumonias, acute respiratory infections, and the acute diarrheal infections, which constitute almost 75% of cases. This is as per 2018 data. So they are the deadliest communicable diseases. And coming to the various countries where the deaths are because of contagious diseases, the highest is South Africa, Pakistan, and India. So we do suffer with a lot of contagious diseases, and we should understand that. And we all know that COVID-19 is a very contagious disease. And this is one of the census as per global health security rank out of 195 countries. So India ranks 57. So the higher the rank, it is the more likelihood that we can suffer with a lot of epidemics. And the lesser the score, again, we are more prone for epidemics. So India is more vulnerable to epidemics compared to even China and Italy also. But we should understand that China and Italy are one of the most affected countries. So we are still doing better because of the current lockdown and the current policies that the government has imposed. So this was as per the data in the 2 years back. So what is happening to the healthcare budgeting in India? So government is spending on healthcare is the lowest compared to the peer and advanced economies. It is even lesser than Mexico and small countries like Turkey. And the other problem is we spend very less on preventive care, that is only 6.8 compared to curative care. So we spend a lot on curative care, writing medications, doing surgeries and other stuff, but we tend to ignore the aspect of preventive care. So what we are discussing today in this webinar is about preventive care so that we can protect ourselves and also our staff and also our hospital, our nursing home, our clinic, as well as our patients. So it is very important. And aptly it was said in that one of the article that we need a reboot of healthcare in India because we need to address all these issues. So one of the issues that we have to consider is structural changes in hospitals and clinics. What is the current challenge? So from next week, most of us will be starting to work more frequently for longer hours. So we need to have three challenges. So what about COVID patients? How to triage them, how to identify the cases and allocate the treatment. And it's more important as cases increase, we have to match the burden of this disease. And it is also important to allocate the treatment for non-COVID emergencies, especially like myocardial infarction, cerebrovascular accidents, other causes of pneumonia, pancreatitis, GI bleed, poisoning, etc. In the same emergency of the same hospital, which must have been designated as COVID-19 hospital. And also, it is important to allocate our treatment facilities for other routine care, either it is a first visit patient or follow-up visit patient. So these are the challenges that we are going to face from next week when we start working for longer hours. So right at the entrance itself, it is always a good idea to establish a screening OPD, like a respiratory screening OPD, like any patient who has these symptoms, they are voluntarily advised to visit this clinic, and staff are allocated there with full personal protective equipment, and they can screen. And this is one of the important change that we need to do. And at the security level itself, as I have mentioned in my previous presentation, there need to be an infrared thermoscanner so that body temperature can be checked for each and every patient as well as relatives. So these are the two things that needs to be done at the entrance of the hospital itself. So one of the thing that we are following at our hospital is these kind of kiosk counters to screen these patients at the entrance level itself. So some kind of physical barrier will be there, and some two holes will be there here where two hands can be brought out and patient can be examined and patient can be questioned. There can be mic inside and outside, like in our box office ticket counters. It is a good idea to follow a protocol to have to do a mandatory chest X-ray for each and every patient, especially those with respiratory symptoms, so that we know that certain patients can be asymptomatic or with predominant GI symptoms and they can still have abnormal chest X-ray, so that we can triage this patient. So putting up these kind of kiosks will also protect the patients as well as the staff from getting in direct contact with the COVID-19 suspect patients. So when the patient comes to the front office, it is always practice that patients tend to crowd around the front office. So it is always a good practice that you encourage the staff to call the patient one day prior and appoint them and give them appointments, and at the same go they can actually inquire if they have COVID related symptoms. And it is important to call the patient one by one only and to avoid crowding at the front office reception. The front office manager, of course, should be protected with full gear PPE. And it is important to actually monitor that they maintain the adequate distance between person to person. So I'm keeping this hand sanitizer picture in every slide because that is the most important, and apart from social distancing. So a practice like this thing will be good, assigning some kind of circles so that patients can maintain adequate distance. The minimum recommended is around 2 meters, in fact. So longer distance circles can be maintained. We have seen this in our newspapers where actually police have marked for vegetable markets where they are advising the customers to stand in that row to actually purchase their vegetables in the vegetable markets and grocery stores. So the same thing can be practiced at the front office also, so that a discipline can be maintained and distance can also be maintained. So same thing can be actually seen at the pharmacy also. We can, and lab, where we can use a kind of counter wherein there will be a physical barrier, a transparent physical barrier between the patient and the pharmacy staff, and medicines can be dispensed through a hole or a small aperture kind of thing. So these things are very important. These and what about entrance doors? So Dr. Khalik has shown up, presented a very interesting cartoon. So it is a common practice that we barge and bang on the doors with our hands and legs. But it is a good idea that we can shift to swing type of doors where we can just use our back or hip or kind of elbow. Or it is always even better if we have automated sensor doors wherein they open and close when they sense the incoming and outgoing of any patient or person. So it's always better to have automated entrance, but it may not be possible outside your OPD chambers where there will be a lock, where there will be a knob like that. In that case, it is advised to have patients to wear a gloves or push it with elbow or shoulder or in fact your back. So that is always better. And it is always important at regular areas outside every room or every 6 to 8 feet, it is always important to install these kind of wall mounted sanitizers. We always see these kind of sanitizers at the bedside of every patient in the ICU or in the general ward also. But it is also important to have this kind of practice of wall mounted sanitizers, so that whenever if somebody has forgotten to wash their hands, it is always important that these, if they are installed, they remind the consultant or the paramedical staff to wash the hands periodically. Establishing signboards is very important. This is very important to actually differentiate between a COVID ward and the non-COVID area isolation wards. It is it gives good signages. It can stop the number of visitors. It can stop the number of unauthorized personnel entering into the hospital, and it can actually demarcate the areas of patients with COVID and without COVID also. Certain help desks also help. We can put kind of standees with educational material regarding coronavirus infection, and also which can patients can read that, and at least they can get educated then and there itself. And if there is any doubt, they can go to the help desk also. Patient spacing, we discussed about doing our OPDs when we are in hospital. But what to do for these patients when they're actually waiting? So encourage the patient to talk, to take prior appointments so that there will be adequate temporal spacing. So it is, as Dr. Khalik told, there should not be a policy of get set go for the consultant as well as for the patient. So it is always better to encourage to have some a gap of 30 minutes for each patient, or at least 20 minutes for each patient. So if there is a spillover, that margin of time is allowed. And this would avoid overcrowding, and we know that overcrowding even in hospital is a big risk factor for spread of this infection. So ensure each patient sits in every third or fourth chair in the OPD waiting hall. That may actually give a distance of 6 to 8 feet, so that there is an adequate distance. And also mark the OP floor, as I've previously described, with some tapes or kind of paint around 1 to 2 meter each, and install stoppers also, so that patient follows a line, and this would maintain adequate spacing, and this would also remind the patient of the rules and the precautions. So this is the kind of thing. I borrowed this slide from my dear colleague Dr. Sridhar from Guntur, who is following this kind of thing. On the right side of the screen, you can see that how patients are sitting in a disciplined way, and they move chair by chair whenever their turn comes. So one or two chairs, leaving one or two chairs are is adequate. And sometimes if in COVID ward, or if you're there is a chance of mix up, then it is always better to maintain longer distance also, at least 2 meters like that. So in chamber, what to do? So patient should be allowed inside with only one caretaker inside the chamber. Who is most responsible, who can understand you, who can listen to you, and you can counsel them in one go. And it is always important and a good idea to remove the patient's stool. Commonly, two relatives will sit in front of you, and one relative, and the patient is going to sit beside you in the patient's stool. So it is always better to remove that stool, because he is the most important suspect of any kind of disease. So I encourage only one relative, and the patient should sit beside them in adequate distance, and from them, from between themselves as well as from you also, on the opposite side of the of your consulting table. So maintain at least 6 to 8 feet difference distance between each other. So don't be over enthusiastic while you're consulting. It is very important to counsel the patients, but we have common practices that we start drawing pictures. We take up our iPad and draw pictures and explain the patient, moving very close to them. But in this period, please avoid that. Let the patient only remain the opposite side, and you remain on the other side, and turn around your computer if possible, and then start explaining to them. Obviously, Indians are very famous for Desi Jugaad. These kind of screens were established in one of the clinics shared through WhatsApp group. Some kind of physical polythene barrier was installed, and doctor physician was examining the patient on the opposite side. So that may prevent physical aerosol. But the problem here is the doctor is not wearing any mask. So please excuse me for that on his behalf. So this is the practice in OPD room. When you're touching an abdomen or doing some kind of physical examination on the other parts of the body, so please be careful to wear outer gloves, as I told you, and same practices should be followed. So coming to the near the theater area, surgeon and staff changing rooms are very important. Please make sure that only one surgeon or staff is present in one room. And when you're donning and doffing, it is very important to follow the protocols. And more importantly, there should be two chairs while you're doffing, as per CDC guidelines, one a clean chair and another a dirty chair. So once you're coming out of the patient care, you have to sit in the dirty chair, make sure that you actually remove everything and sanitize yourself, remove the PPE, and then move on to the clean chair. So it is very important not to mix it up. And of course, in the OTs, negative pressure laminar flow rooms, majority of the OTs have this. So I need not emphasize on that. There may not be much of things need to be changed in this area. In the scrub area, in the wash area, it is always better to have leg controls or automated sensors and avoid contact with hands and fingers. And I'm sure my surgical colleagues will be following all these things. Regarding doors, again, OT doors, there are many kinds of OT doors, but it is always better to have a kind of sensor. Like if you see in this area on the right side of the slide, lowermost corner, this is the leg sensor. So you can just raise your leg in front of this sensor and automatically this door opens and closes, rather than this kind of thing where you need to actually barge inside by pushing it, which is not recommended. Most importantly, our critical care colleagues, anesthesia colleagues, they have the habit of actually leaning forward and doing intubation. And patient may be coughing, and though how much soever you are protected with the personal protective equipment, you can still have this risk of exposure. And as shown in one of the recent NEJM paper, that using ultraviolet rays, fluorescent dye is put up in the simulator, and a cough simulation was made, and when the mannequin coughs, the doctor is filled up with entire these kind of droplets, and these are potential aerosols that can infect you. So this practice is very bad, so please avoid all these things. A simple modification is this kind of box made with acrylic of this kind of measurement, 62x47, with two holes, and the performer will actually wear full PPE, and the patient will be inside this box right from the mid chest till few centimeters away from the head level. And through these two hands, all the anesthesia equipment, the intubation equipment, can be actually managed, and patient can be intubated safely. So this is actually published. This is called barrier enclosure, and there are various modifications that have been coming up in the WhatsApp. So you may take up any of those things. So inside the OR, this is one of my dear colleague and colleague surgeon who is doing. And he is with full personal protective equipment. You can see that there is no skin exposed to any of the free air, both of them. And there will be minimal staffing. So please provide, ensure that there will be full personal protective equipment in the OT, and there is minimal staff. But you should ensure that there is maximum patient safety, and also you should protect yourself maximum. So my colleagues and myself started using this kind of face shields to actually prevent the direct aerosol contact when you're doing some kind of endoscopies or when you're intubating. So it is always encouraged to have these kind of stuff. So coming to the endoscopy suites, this is one of the presentations from Professor G.S. Raju. So if you are bound to do an endoscopy for a COVID positive patient, you should anticipate it. So it is always better to designate this area as COVID negative or positive at the reception area, as well as the preparation area, as well as in the endoscopy rooms, including the changing rooms. And immediately all the equipment should go into the soil scope cleaning for cleaning and disinfection. So it is always better to demarcate these areas. So physically also, so that there will not be any mix up as you are doing it in the wards also. So importantly, about the ICUs, there will be most of the corporate hospitals will have multiple ICUs in multiple floors, like surgical ICU is next to the surgical floor, that is the OTs, and medical ICU is next to the in the first floor, like that. So multiple ICUs are there. So you can designate them as COVID ICUs and non-COVID ICUs separately. It is just a matter of identification and redistributing them. And similar practices need to be followed even in the accident and emergency department, that is casualties or emergency rooms. So it's very important to avoid these mix-ups. And as I showed, signage boards are very important, and there should be separate hospital entrances, as released by one of the GOs from Andhra Pradesh. They have suggested to have separate hospital entrances, and floors can be identified for other admitted patients, like first floor is for this patient category of patients, second floor is for this category of patients, so that there will not be any mix-up in these wards. And washrooms, very importantly, majority of hospitals have these kind of washrooms where people go chit-chatting, and it's a common practice. And sometimes there may be one toilet, and a lot of people will be waiting in the queue. So we should not ignore this area, because there can be even virus shedding is noted in the feces, and there can be aerosol spread through the toilets also. So it is always better if you have these kind of things to actually use alternate toilets, alternate urinals, so that the alternate urinals can be used, so that physical and social distancing can be maintained. Or it is best to actually use a single toilet and promote and encourage people using only those toilets rather than the in a group. And obviously, if you can't manage anything, please ask your security to be more polite at the wash areas and ask them to control the crowd. Not to forget about the patient waiting areas, especially in the IP, when the patient waiting areas, especially in the ICU patients, if they are waiting for the relatives are waiting outside, there should not be any mix-up. There should not be any mix-up at the laundry. Again, assign separate machines and launderers for that. Washrooms we have discussed, especially the biomedical waste management services, you have to see that there is no mix-up at the sewage level, and canteen Dr. Khalik has discussed, and maintain adequate staffing for each and every area. And also it is important to have good quarantine facilities even for your own healthcare staff. Like in our hospital and majority of the hospitals, they have separate hostels for the nursing staff and other staff, and they maintain some kind of rooms or kind of guest houses around the hospital, so that if a doctor needs some kind of rest or need to quarantine himself, they need not go to the hospital, they need not go to the their house, and they can use these kind of things. So it's always a good idea to provide quarantine facilities for your healthcare staff as well. And obviously, we should understand that it is not responsibility of Prime Minister, it's not responsibility of a single drug. It is responsibility for all of us to actually stop this coronavirus and deal with these difficult times. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
Thank you very much, Chalapathy. Before going to question and answer session, I would like to congratulate and thank the speakers for their extensive research they have done for this webinar. And many of us may be thinking that we are immune to COVID-19 because we have MBBS degree or something like that. So that is not correct, because around 500 doctors worldwide have died because of COVID-19 as of now. Around 42,000 of healthcare workers are infected with COVID-19. So it's very common infectious disease, and we should take care as the speakers told us to do. So now I invite the questions with Mr. Arjun. Is asked about money transaction. What about money transaction? Probably Dr. Ahmed covered that topic. You want to tell in very quick this thing?
Yeah. Most of the money that should be done the transaction between the patients and the hospital or the clinics should be primarily through a digital platform. There are so many wallets are present, as well as Google Pay, Paytm, etc. Preferably, we should insist to our patients to pay the money through digital platform. The second preferable is using a card and swipe. But in India, though we push for digital payment, still there may be some amount of some people who will prefer to pay money through the cash itself. While taking the cash, the person who is in charge of taking the cash, the cashier, dedicated cashier, or a person in the front office person, they should be wearing an extra gloves, and they should be dedicated only for taking the money. They should not be allowed to touch the phones, etc. And once they take in the money, they have to keep it in a separate box. And as we know that the virus can stay for a few days, some reports says that it stays for 3 to 4 days on a paper, and some reports says that it can stay up to 9 to 10 days. Whatever the money is collected, once the counting is done, that money should not be reused again for at least 10 days. After 10 days, that money can be used for a circulation point of view. Yeah.
Okay. Now I allow Dr. Srinagesh to ask the question. Srinagesh, you can unmute and ask your question.
Hi friends, I just got one question.
One minute.
I had one query about your money. Usually people are saying it's only for 24 hours. Mm-hmm. The money part is only for 24 hours. And you're telling mm-hmm. me that it's for 10 days.
Mm-hmm. So some reports have come that on a paper it stays for 3 to 4 days. There's one more report which says that it is going to stay for around 7 to 9 days. Okay. So we don't know for how long it is there. So it's always better once we take it, the cash, seal yes. that box off and reuse it after 10 days, preferably after keeping in the sunlight.
Yeah, that is a very good idea.
Right.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nagesh. I invite Kim to ask question. Kim, you can unmute and ask your question. Yeah, please go ahead.
Hello. Yeah. I'm Dr. Satish. Gastroenterologist from Tirupati. Why can't we take a complete history through phone and review the patient's reports and everything through WhatsApp so that we can minimize the contact with the patient? So whatever required physical examination can be completed and history will take through phone. Why definitely. Can't we do like that?
Yeah, definitely, Dr. Sir, that is one of the very good suggestions. Actually, we are planning to do one more follow-up session in the next week, first part of the next week, wherein we are trying to see that how this digital technology, whether they be apps or web-based or WhatsApp or Google Duo or whatever, how can we use it to complement to our practice, wherein our type of clinical care that we are giving is not compromised. So we will be coming forth with this concept and we'll be taking your inputs also to how better to use these digital platforms and what are the different platforms, and we will try to assess them and go slightly into the depth. Me and Chalapati are planning to do it in the first week of the next week, first half of the next week. Thank you.
I know.
How about making now the emergency cases will allow all the non-emergency cases who come for follow-up? How about keeping some IT personals who will put all their old record, important record, into digitalize them? We should make the for the follow-up cases at least paperless.
Yes.
Number one. This was my first question. The second question is, how about the patients who come? They should not be allowed to carry fomites with them, and they carry bags, so many records, X-rays, all those things. They should be allowed to keep them at the entrance, and their hands should be sanitized. This sanitizer, the security person, I have seen the supermarkets there. They spray on the hands. They just rub it as if it's a scent, something like a scent or something. They're not rubbing it. So most of the people do not know how to use the sanitizer. Sanitizer has to be rubbed nicely into the creases and the nail bed and everywhere. That's not being followed. They are thinking that when that chemical is sprayed on your hands, it's enough. Everything is killed. No, it's not like that. So one thing is this. So how about, is there any substitute which can usually be more stronger? Can we ask them to dip their hands like that, In old days, when I used to study in Usmania, we used to have two bowls, with a towel. One used to have Dettol water, another used to have clean water. We used to dip our hands in Dettol water, take out our hands, and then dip it into the other hand. Such things can be kept and frequently changed so that the people rub their hands in that and come. What is the efficacy of this thing compared to this not properly used sanitizer? Thank you. Will you give me a clear picture about this? I'll be happy.
Yeah. Sir, regarding the first part of the question, so if practically I want to say we also run an healthcare IT company and we have our application. What I practically am planning to do at this point of time is we have a citizen's application wherein they can upload the reports which I will be able to see it digitally. Or if we don't have the application, the simple thing is before the patients come to the hospital, we should encourage them that they should call to the hospital and take a prior appointment. Once prior appointment is taken, the second aspect that our staff should give to the patient and their attendants are, please upload all your old relevant records, whether it be previous prescriptions or previous reports, including the medicines the pictures of the medicines has to be taken a picture and sent on a WhatsApp so that our staff will forward it to us. So whenever the patient comes, we go, we open our maybe our laptop or our tablet and see into the reports of the patients rather than touching all the reports which they are carrying, which may have the chances of fomites. The second aspect, sir, as you suggested, one thing that is present in the Disney World is also that there have a large washing machine like things are there in which both hands can be dipped and alcohol based diluted solutions are present in which the kids will keep their hands there, wash it and they will bring it out. As you suggested in the previous era, there used to be two balls used to be there. One was with the Dettol or the Savlon, and that was a clean thing. But yeah, sir, this can be used. But if we are seeing more number of patients, right? We need to balance depending upon our comfortability by keeping our hands and washing it repeatedly within such type of a disinfecting solution is better, or using some gloves as suggested by Chalpati, which can be thrown, taken out and thrown after each and every patient is there. Depends upon one's own preferences. We can stick on to any of the things. Chalpati, you want to add anything?
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, fine. I think practicing inner and outer gloves is also important, but even we have to sanitize those inner gloves also each time, because you will be handling your pens and papers when you are wearing your inner gloves. Once you start writing the prescription and all, you will remove the outer gloves and start using them. Still, we have to sanitize. So, as of now, as you told, I think alcohol-based sanitizers are better.
Yeah, okay. Dr. Srinagesh, you want to ask any question?
Yeah, I've got one query about... am I audible now?
Yes, Nagesh.
Yeah, I've got one query about the medico-legal implications of patients not sticking to the safe distancing guidelines. If somebody doesn't do it, are we well within our rights to refuse to see the patient? If it doesn't comply with the clinic?
Yes, I think as I told you in my first presentation, we created a informed consent and patient checklist wherein actually patient has to sign, and there is a compliance form also that they will be adhering to the social distancing guidelines and all. So in fact, one of my colleagues actually refused to see the patient. In fact, we should all do that if patient is not ready to sign it up.
That's become a big problem nowadays.
True. That's true. You have every right to reject the patient.
Yeah.
So I invite OnePlus to ask the question. The login ID OnePlus.
Hello.
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
Yeah. Just small notice to you. You notice. Just you mentioned about Dr. Sitaraf's OP. While arranging the chairs and moving from one chair to another chair, that also not practicable because we are shifting to the one patient to another patient position.
True. I agree.
The patient has to come from the one to the directly to the examination chair before, after getting sanitized that chair also.
That's not a good practice. So that's why actually practicing in a common room is also not good. Shifting chairs is also not good.
Yes.
Whenever we see actually a mix-up of all these things, we need to disinfect everything.
Sir, ideally separating patients rather than in space, I think it is more better to separate them by time. Say if my time of consultation with each and every patient is say around 10 minutes, it's better by I separate giving one appointment to the second appointment by 20 or 25 minutes or 30 minutes so that the crowding within the waiting area will be bare.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Kali, some YouTube viewers is asking that some of the clinics are very small, where there is no scope of having a separate OP for general and COVID suspected patients. What to do in such situation?
Separating by time.
Okay.
Separating by time and going to digital platform for follow-up cases.
Okay. Arjun from YouTube is asking, any problem with usage of AC? What kind of AC? Centralized AC, window AC, what kind of AC is suitable?
Air conditioning.
Air conditioning in OPD or hospital or clinics, is it advisable or what? Or what kind of air conditioning is better? Centralized AC or window AC?
Do you want to take?
I think there are some concerns about sucking up air and all, but it is always better to have if you are following the other strict protocols to screen the COVID patients from non-COVID patients to separate them and all, you can as well use your regular air conditioners, because it may be difficult to change everything, including the air conditioners. Some of the hospitals may be having central air conditioners, so it may be difficult. So all of a sudden, if you ask the hospital to change to a negative suction area, negative suction room, it may be difficult. So if you follow the protocols of checklist, triaging and all, probably you are separating majority of or all of the patients from your OPD so that you are not at risk. But if you have an option to do that in your clinic, probably you can shift on to a negative suction area.
Okay. Quite a few attendees are telling the extensive information you people have given, but they're feeling it is difficult to implement. What are your comments?
So it's just a thought process which we have to implement. So depending, the practicing places will vary depending upon a small clinics with a single room to a larger corporate hospital or a larger institutes. So depending upon, one thing is clear that we are amidst of a storm of a COVID-19 pandemic, right? We have to get prepared for ourselves. So as much as possible, implementation here is not a choice, but it is mandatory, right? For the things which are required to protect ourselves, our staff, etc., is not a thing of choice, but it is mandatory.
Majority of whatever we have spoken is may not be in the literature, except very few. But it actually follows the general guidelines and our learnings of infection control and protocols to prevent infection and asepsis. In busy practice, we tend to forget majority of the things. So if we actually get some information through this webinar, we practice some certain kind of things, at least we can, it's like a brush up.
One thing Dr. Mohan Patro has asked, that doctors above 65 years have to attend the hospital at least twice in a week, rarely comes in contact with non-COVID patients. What precautions we should take with our family members? Sir, good evening. One thing is, as I discussed, it's always better, rather than working twice a week or thrice a week, it's better to divide into 15-day slot. The reason being that if one half of the team get quarantined, the other half can take care of the clinical work so that the hospital and the department can keep running. Second thing is, without extensive testing, all our potential contacts, the patients who are for us for follow-up, or each and every, including our staff members, are potential coronaviral infection patients. So we can't say that these people are corona positive and these people are not corona positive. In spite of having down the line, we may be getting clearly the antibody testing thing, but still, for the antibody to come positive, it will take at least 4 days to 1 week of time. So with sure, we can't say that this patient is a corona positive or a corona not positive. Our attitude and mindset should be, with each and every interaction that we are happening, our interaction is happening, we have to consider them as a corona positive patient and has to take our due precautions. What things we have to do with our family members? First thing is, sir, as I suggested, once coming to home, we have to remove our clothes, we have to keep our shoes outside, take a shower, and only then come out and meet with the family. It's always better to maintain the physical distance with the family members, particularly with the elders if they are at home. A third thing is, whenever if at least the smallest tinge of any symptoms are there, we should not be overconfident that it is a simple sore throat or a simple headache because of sleeplessness, etc. So we should be getting ourselves tested for that one. And what extra precautions we should take? Social distancing is one thing. Second thing is, sir, our plates and drinking glasses should be different should be labeled and should be different when compared, and we should be using our own utensils of eating and drinking water. And if there are multiple bathrooms out there, it's always better that the people who go to the hospital, they use a separate bathroom when compared to the other family members.
Okay. Mr. Pandurang Krishna, you want to ask some question?
Dr. Pundrik Aksha.
Yeah.
Sir.
Myself, after having heard all the discussions that are discussed here for the last 1.5 hours, how far it is practicable in our setup?
Sir, this was only an overview by keeping in mind, right, from a smaller clinic to a bigger hospital. So one thing we should be very clear that we have to be much, much extra cautious than what we used to practice. Our practice is going to be completely different for at least next 6 months. And depending upon our setup, whether a small clinic or this thing, what are all the things that we need to implement so that we can reduce the infection. Say in a bigger corporate hospital, they can keep in a sensor-based hand wash right at the entrance. But in a small clinic, we can keep a simple wash basin and train one of the staff members that whenever a patient comes, we need to ask them to wash their hands thoroughly and showing them exactly how to wash their hands and then send it. So depending upon our setups, we need to innovate or we need to change them accordingly. This is not that everything fits for each and every clinic. Depending upon that one, we should take care that all the patients who enter us are entering after a thorough washing of the hands with the soap or by using a proper sanitizer and washing their hands. We should be advising them to come in only with the mask, with limited number of attendants, as Shilpati was saying, and we should emphasize that they should not touch anything. We should make our protocol so that the patients doesn't wait for a longer period of time. The minimal contact or a no-touch policy should be there as much as possible from the clinician's point of view. Maximum report should be seen on a digital platform through WhatsApp or a web-based thing. And when examination has to be done, a due precaution should be done as if the patient is a corona positive patient, and then proceed. So these are the few basics that we need to keep in mind, and depending upon the size of the room in which we are practicing, the type of the clinic or the practice things, we need to innovate ourselves and see that at each and every step, right from the patient coming to the clinic and leaving the clinic, or coming to the hospital and leaving the hospital, whether OPD or an IPD or a procedure, we need to see what are the different places where the chances of infection are there, what better we can do. So we have to work into this one, sir, and try to implement.
Question to Dr. Khalik. So if we actually remember our olden days, childhood days, we used to live in an independent house, individual house, right? So we used to have at least some kind of backyard, and usually our restrooms or washrooms are placed away from our house, actually. So we used to wash our hands, our legs, take a bath there itself, and then enter the home. Now, yes, we are living in flats or apartments where there is a mix up at multiple levels, at the parking, at the security, at the lift or at the staircase, and we all, I think more than 99% or 100% of us have actually attached bathrooms, attached toilets to close to our bedrooms, and we have to cross our main hall where kids may be playing. We have to cross the bedroom and then enter the toilet to follow all these protocols. So what is your modification in this current era?
Yeah, one thing, as I said, first thing is, as we come out, recently evidence has also come that from the food source also this virus can be transmitted. That's the reason why I said we have to keep the shoe covers within the car, so that we wear the shoe covers, go to the hospital with those covers, right? And from hospital, once we come, we take out those shoe covers and keep in the small dustbin which we are keeping within the car, right? So that can be excluded. So whatever the shoe is there, that is probably uninfected. Second thing that we are doing is, once we come out, we are leaving all our footwear outside of the home and coming in. Third thing, for an extra precaution, if we want to keep, we can keep our own pair of slippers right at the entrance of the home, the main gate, right? Once we enter our apartment, we wear onto that slippers and directly wash it into the bathroom by going through the hall as well as our bedroom. Third thing is, we need to communicate with our elders as well as particularly with the kids, because they don't understand. Once we come home, there are so many kids who come and work, particularly small kids are there. We need to make them understand that our behavior may be changed for a few months, and our closeness of the time may be difficult in the coming few months. That we need to communicate with the kids that we should not be touching once we come to the hospital. And once we these are a few things that can be done after coming back to normal.
Yeah, thank you.
Should we take some more questions, colleagues?
Yeah.
So I think there are a few more questions.
Okay, if we finish it first. Asked by Uttra Mohan that can we use formalin chambers or UV chambers for patient files, violates, mobile?
Yeah, UV has formalin.
Formalin chambers.
Formalin chambers, I'm not aware. But UV has been shown to be having good, denaturating agent against this one. This has been proposed for denaturating the virus, particularly on the masks, etc. If there is a luxury of having a such type of UV chambers, we can use it. Second thing is about the formalin, I am not aware, but one thing that has come about reusing of the N95 masks is one study from Duke University has come, wherein they have aerosolized hydrogen peroxide into small aerosols, and these aerosols were given to the mask for a certain period of time, after which the masks were fit to be reused. By using the formalin, can we make that small size of the aerosols? I am not aware of that one. If that is the condition, we need to look into the literature for how effective it is for denaturing the virus.
And further, she adds that patient linen can be ETO sterilized.
Patient's linen, yes, can be. Patients, and one thing that we proposed previously is there is a lot of hangama about the PPEs, but one PPE that I think is a must is the N95 mask. Or in a simple word, if I want to say, going to the hospital or a clinic without N95 mask is as equivalent to going out of the home without clothes. Right? So that is the importance of a N95 mask. The rest of, particularly the body, the second important thing is we need to have a proper gloves. That is the second important PP, which is important. The third thing is we should have the footwear. These three are quintessential. The fourth one, which is recommended, is to cover our head, right? The fifth one, which is recommended, is to cover our body. As most of the hospitals will have a large surgical gowns, which are made up of the linen. This can be used because if the virus comes, our body or our skin on the exterior doesn't have these ACE2 receptors. So if at all the patient's fomites or secretions or blood spills on our body due to some accident or during some procedure, the virus is not going to enter our body right from the skin. So the chances of that one are less likely, particularly in the OPD and less aerosol generating procedures. So a simple gown that we commonly use in a surgical procedure with a full hands and a linen based head cover and a good linen based shoe covers can stitch for about 3 or 4 sets of this one, which once we use it on that day, we can wash them in the hot water, dry them and can reuse. In that way, our spending on the PPE can come down significantly. Only PPE on which I personally believe that we should spend are N95 masks and second one are the gloves. These two non-sterile gloves. These are the two things on which we need to spend. The rest all we can use the cloth-based or linen-based PPE, maybe 3 sets or 4 sets or 5 sets, depending upon our practice, and wash them and dry them and we can reuse them.
Dr. Milind is asking, can government make us to work even if we don't want to work? Because some may be having some comorbidity, or maybe having some, some doctor may be elderly age group 60, 65. If they don't want to work, or anybody for that matter, don't want to work.
There is one act which is ASMA in Andhra Pradesh. Chalpati will be in a better position to answer that one. But no one can force anyone to push to the hospital. Obviously, I do feel that particularly elderly people, elderly doctors or doctors, senior doctors or doctors who are having comorbidities like diabetes or hypertension, which is quite common, or people who are having a COPD or such type of high risk group of practicing physicians, it's always advisable not to venture into to go for a practice so affluently, just to wait and see for under 2 weeks or 4 weeks how the rate of infection is going and what actually the data from India is coming, how much is the mortality rate, right? And then take a guarded way of practicing, because we have seen so many of our colleagues, at least two colleagues in Andhra Pradesh have died because of this corona infection. And in India also, we are seeing that the doctors are dying. So it's better maybe if we are having a bit of comorbidities, to at least wait for 2 weeks, 4 weeks, and see and assess what the data is saying, how infectious our this type of the virus is present, that is present in India, and how good our facilities are able to tackle them, and then venture into practice.
Dr. Mohammed is asking, can N95 be reused?
Yes, N95 has to be reused in a country like India. We don't have a luxury of not using this respirator for a single time. Yeah, for reusing, how many times to reuse? One of our colleague has asked. We don't have a clear-cut idea how many times we need to use, but two or three things are there. In N95, there are small microfibers are there. So the more you use, the more efficient it becomes. It is not like it will become less efficient, because whenever the virus particles comes, there are three or four mechanisms by which the virus is obstructed. One is the mechanical thing. Second one is a stereotactic charging is there. There is diffraction, so that the virus will get engulfed. Not only the virus, but the other particles would get engulfed within these layers of N95. So what happens is, once we reuse it repeatedly, the chances of breathe, that there will be much more difficulty in breathing in and breathing out. That is the time when we should be actually changing it. Practically, there are two ways of using it. If you are having less number of N95 masks, there should be at least two, so that the once we are using the first one, the second one we can denaturize it by using a microwave method, which is well described, by steaming this outer surface of the N95 by keeping in a microwave for at least a half an hour of time, which can be reused. The second method, which is advised, is by keeping the N95 mask aside without using for at least 4 days, either keeping within the sunlight or keeping aside and not using it. One thing that I suggested is using a Tupperware or a glass-based tiffin box, in which we have to take our N95 mask, cover it, write it, okay, this is mask number one. And if it is placed on the sunlight, after 4 days, it can be reused as the fifth one. These are the two practical ways how a smaller clinic or a smaller setup can be used. But in a bigger setup, UV sterilization can be done, or there are places wherein, as I discussed, H2O2 aerosol sterilization is being done. Depending upon the hospital policies, it has to be used. But in a smaller setup, either using 4 N95 masks by using the sunlight or keeping aside, or at least 2 N95 masks wherein a microwave can be used, in which by steam we can denaturize the mask.
Last question for the day is asked by Dr. Vaseem. He's asking, nowadays many patients are drinking cold water and come with acute pharyngitis or tonsillitis. How can we avoid examining the throat of the patient?
Yeah, valid question, Dr. Vaseem. So the reason, before examining the patient, what is the reason why we are examining, right? The reason for why we are examining is to make a clinical diagnosis of these patients. So if you think that examining this patient is the sore throat or the pharyngitis, either by drinking cold water, allergic thing, or a viral thing, or a bacterial thing, unless proven otherwise, all patients are COVID positive. We have to keep it in mind, right? Second thing is, whenever there is a dire requirement of examining the patient, it's better you wear a proper PPE, including the face shield, and examine that one by using a flexible endoscope, by being away from the patient, either or examine it. But the second thing that can be done is, you can stand by the on the backside of the patient, use your mirror, which is used for indirect laryngoscope, right? And ask the patient to open the mouth. By standing behind, keep the indirect laryngoscope mirror close to his mouth and examine the things. These are the two things that come to my mind. Either you use a flexible endoscope by staying away, or stand behind the patient and use an indirect laryngoscope, ask the patient to open the mouth and examine his pharynx.
Okay. With this, as a one of our attendees has put in the comment section that it's a webinar is very timely and very informative session. So with the, I thank both the speakers as well as attendees and UMDA Healthcare for initiating this webinar. Thank you.
Thanks for conducting. Thanks for moderating.
Thank you. Thank you for participation. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.